it's already thrilling to see the connections between some of the foundational cultural historical information as we're getting into more of the musical conversations, how an understanding of some of that history, culture, the sounds, the music, the diversity of music in Mexico is connecting and providing some context for the musical styles and the diversity that we're hearing and seeing in this music. So this is a very exciting day and very exciting event. And that will continue now with our special guests, Eric Jimenez and Cory Meals. Cory's title, Life in the Hyphen, I think sums up what his experience has been, and I'll let him speak with our guest Cory Meals on what the kind of current state or the experience of growing up in the borderlands and in educational environments, and what the current state of representation in educational environments looks like, or and beyond educational environments. So with it, thank you so much. This is Eric Jimenez and Cory Meals.
Thank you, everybody. I have to acknowledge something though about community. I was connected in the symposium in the sense of through a podcast, and it all started when I got interviewed, and Sixto actually heard that interview, sent me a message and said, hey, your story is unlike anything I've heard, especially in our profession. From there, he's been a guest on my podcast. And from there, I met Brian. So I say that because it's going to tie into my presentation. All right. And then I'm joined here by who I consider my mentor and a professor as well from the University of Houston, that his work will pretty much outline as to why my experience was the way it was. So I have the honor and privilege of representing my family today. And that's kind of what I wanted to encapsulate first, because this session is, I could have gone hours talking about my life, obviously. And so I had to ask folks, like, you know me, how should I summarize in 30 to 45 minutes my life as a music student? And I got so many ideas, but I felt like this video really kind of tied it all in together.
Play Mexico?
Dad, a gig in Monterrey, Mexico.
Dad, that would be so cool.
I'm not sure of that right now.
Come on, Dad.
Hey, Dad, you always said everything's a risk, right?
They don't accept us with it. They never have.
Hello, we're Mexican.
No, we are Mexican-American, and they don't like Mexican-American.
That's all the same.
And they can be mean, and they can tear us apart over there. Selena's Spanish is...
What about my Spanish? I've been singing in Spanish for 10 years. It's perfect.
Singing, yes, but when you speak it a little funny. And down there, you gotta speak perfectly, or the press will eat you up and spit you out alive. I've seen them do it.
Overreacting as usual.
Dad, the music will speak for itself, Dad.
Listen, being Mexican-American is tough. Anglos jump all over you if you don't speak English perfectly. Mexicans jump all over you if you don't speak Spanish perfectly. We gotta be twice as perfect as anybody else. Why are you laughing?
So just in case you don't know where that's from the movie Selena. And that just pretty much summarizes sometimes how people like me feel. Ni de aquí, ni de allá is a phrase that we use that I've heard all my life, where you say you're not from here nor over there. And most recently in dealing with the dualities, especially living in this hyphen, folks are advocating that we are from there and from here. We are 100% Mexican and 100% American, instead of viewing us as half and half. So I had to acknowledge my family in this journey. My father, who is actually in the baby picture up here, was born in Ciudad Juarez. And so my mother was actually born in Mesilla, New Mexico, but was raised in Camargo, Chihuahua, both of which are from the state of Chihuahua. And through, my father was the eldest of 11 and got sponsored through our aunt, his aunt, that was a postmaster general in New Mexico to go study. And he paid her back every summer to go to UTEP in El Paso. Got his electrical engineering degree, got an opportunity to work for General Electric. So in 1975, he got a job in Houston, showed up, and they're like, we don't have a job for you. And he decided to stay. And then so he bought a house and brought the rest of his siblings and my grandparents. And so now Houston is home. So the vast majority of my family from the Jimenez side lives in Houston. And that's my beautiful family, the most recent picture on Mother's Day when we celebrated. And I can't thank them enough. So I had to like call my dad and my mom and talk about like, all right, tell me the year that you ended up in New York and what'd you go up there for? And he's like, it was just a training for General Electric, got me to Houston. But this is how my family ended up in Houston. But every summer and any chance that we got, we were driving from Houston to El Paso. And in case you don't know how many hours that is, that's 12 hours. We would do it in one shot, by the way. It was always one of those things. You got the burritos packed, órale, and subas en el carro. And then it was just go. And I remember those times thinking, I don't want to do this. My friends go to Disney World. My friends go camping, and I'm sweating in a car that might have AC heading over to Juarez. But now when I think about it in retrospect, it became and it molded me who I am, because I can think of those moments with my sister and I. A rule in our home was, en la casa se habla español. At home, you speak Spanish, but otherwise you can speak English. And so, but the rule was when we crossed the border, we couldn't speak English. And so my sister and I would jokingly be like talking in English, and we would see the Mexican flag right at Puente Zaragoza in Juarez, and we would switch over to Spanish. That's just a lived experience for me. So it starts reflecting now in music. Because of that, I can think of a nostalgic moment in my life driving from Houston to El Paso, listening to Pepe Aguilar's Con Tambor. It's one of his like 1990 albums, and it's just a banda sinaloense a todo. And so what I do now, any road trip I go on with my family, I play that album just as a nod of recognition to my father, but because I love the music. And so I kind of want to have those memories with my kids. But I want to walk you through what I would consider my life soundtrack and give you an insight on sounds you would have heard at a quinceañera, at a wedding, at a carne asada, at somebody just playing the radio outside, washing the car, just to give you an insight. Let me lower it down, bring this down a little bit. So, if you heard me test it earlier, I chose Selena, given she's from Texas, an identifier for me. She's Mexican-American in the limelight. There was nobody like that. So that was huge for me. But I am from inner city Houston. I grew up in hip-hop. I am screw music to the day that I die. So this was popularized by Robert Davis Jr., known as DJ Screw, and so I was raised on it. So what you're hearing now is a screw and chop version of cumbia. So my two worlds were colliding and mixing, and I was like, this is so cool. So I chose to become a DJ after that for 15 years. But as I mentioned, we're from Chihuahua, so you're gonna hear the saxophone in rancheras and norteño music. So that is a huge staple for me. Los Raileros, I can promise you this song was played at every event. But the accordion was huge for me. And Los Tigres del Norte, whether it was La Puerta Negra or La Camila La Tejana, it was, I know the word, the song word for word. But we wrap it all together with Vicente Fernandez, and specifically El Rey. Even though José Alfredo Jimenez is the one that actually recorded this piece, it's been popularized and mostly widely known through Vicente Fernandez, may he rest in peace. So all these albums give a representation and kind of just summarize my lived experience through music, okay? Notice I didn't play any classical music, all right? Now, but again, it was reaffirmed and over by my father. It was never a conversation of assimilation. It was never that. It was one, Palacio de Bellas Artes is one of the most beautiful places in the world. And he would tell me about Juan Gabriel's concert there and Luis Miguel's concert there and Ana Gabriel and La Sinfónica. And he would always talk about it with so much pride, even though I've never been. I had never been when he would talk to me about it. And then when he would talk, and then Sunday mornings, si está cantando José Alfredo or Vicente, he would do it with pride. If a mariachi was present, he was either singing El Rey or singing El Corrido Chihuahua. And I was raised with that. And I remember, I never had shame. I know I had friends who were like, man, Apa, why are you getting up there? Like, sit down. And I would be the kid that would say, hey, Apa, suele. Entrele, go and do it. And then sometimes people be like, cállate, like, déjame solo. But this is just an example. This is my niece and nephew with my father. Now the second generation is getting the same experience that I got. One of admiration for our culture and our home country, even though we weren't born there. Now, I can't say that for some of my friends. I can't say that for some of my colleagues, where I have to acknowledge their lived experiences, especially if they lived during the time of civil rights and they were chastised and punished for speaking Spanish in school. I met one of the LULAC historians that told me he had to pee on himself as an elementary kid because he did not know how to ask to go to the restroom in English. And so when you think, and then he had to kneel on bricks as punishment. And if you're a child and you go through that trauma, I know as a parent, I would not want to impose that on my kids. So the initial reaction is assimilate, become part of the dominant culture. And so I've acknowledged when people say, oh, no eres Mexicano, you're not Mexican enough, or you're not Latino enough because you don't speak Spanish. No, that's not an indicator or a marker of being that. So my father taught me that. He is the person who has allowed me to get me to this point. So my session is going to summarize kind of the different eras of my life. I took you to a life soundtrack, and then I'm going to take you through my K-12 experience myself, my experience as an undergrad student at an HBCU, which stands for a historically black college university. I'm going to take you through my teaching career and present day. So my middle school and high school teaching experience. If you can tell, I was secure in my identity. There was no hesitation. But in high school and middle school, I didn't say I was Hispanic. I didn't say I was Latino. I said I was Mexican. Oh, no, but you were born here. Yeah, I'm Mexican, though. And they would ask, and like, and I would have friends. I'm like, hey, where's your mom from? From Mexico? Oh, so you're Mexican? No, I'm Hispanic. And I'm like, you're Mexican. You know, and I would, but I was just so sure of myself. Now, in doing my research and identity work, I've recognized that people can identify how they wish. Whether you want to use Latinx or Latine or Latin asterisk or Hispanic, because the majority of the population at times don't even use that. My family don't use those terms, but they say somos Mexicanos. And so I was very secure in my identity. But as you heard from Dr. Sixto earlier, I played two songs remotely Latino in middle school. The first was La Cucaracha and the second was the Mexican Hat Dance. And they were in the Essential Elements book. And just FYI, and I hope they don't mind me sharing this, but Hal Leonard is actually working on removing those songs from their books. They understand it's going to be a hard initiative to reprint all that. So instead of having to reprint, they're going to expose and put out. Instead of taking out two, they're going to replace with several that are more authentic and relevant to the identity and the culture. Just want to put that out there. I'm working with them on that. High school. I had two. They're remotely Latino. The first was in my jazz ensemble. We played El Cumbanchero, which is a Cuban piece. The second, we did a marching show that was titled Latin Fire. Goes into the stereotypes a little bit that we were talking about earlier. In the fire, we played Oye Como Va and Ran Can Can. Yet again, not really, again, and it ties into the previous presentation. At least it was aligning to my Latinidad. So I heard sounds that I recognized. I knew Oye Como Va, I knew Ran Can Can, so I was at least a little bit more prone to want to practice that. But I was playing cumbia, so if you're familiar with this artist named Fito Olivares, all right, his son was in my marching band with me. Fito would go to our football games, and it was funny because I'm like fangirling because I chose to play saxophone because of Fito. And so I'm seeing him, I'm conducting, I'm drum major, and I'm seeing him in the stands with his shades on, and all my colleagues, because I went to a very diverse high school, my white friends are like, who is that? And I was like, that's Fito. But he and his son, we would play cumbias in the band hall after practice, after everybody was done. But the orchestra director, where we shared the space, would come out and say, don't play that in here. We don't play that music here. In high school, I got a conjunto invitation. My father's best friend was like, hey, dile Eric, I want him to play saxophone for me. And it was a estilo like Los Reyleros. And so I talked to my dad. He's like, dale, if you want to do it, go for it. I think they're going to get signed with Univision. And I was all excited. I go to my band directors. Nope, you shouldn't do that. It's going to take you time away from what we're doing here. So I didn't do that. One actually told me that it would mess up my embouchure. I had a desire to learn mariachi, but limited to no access, even in the state of Texas when I was growing up. Now it's much better, but even then it was limited because I was so hardcore of being a marching band traditional student that I chose to, should I stick with this or should I branch off to things that I know sound like my life soundtrack? So in it changed for me. It changed some things because I joined an HBCU marching band, which I get the honor and privilege to assist now as one of the directors. In case you don't know, I don't like using this example, but like the movie Drumline, if you've seen that, all right? We are modeled after that style, but we're better. And so all that to say, it changed my mind. It changed my perspective of how we do music because I was the only Latino in the band program my freshman year. At a historically black, and I was okay with that. I understood. I'm walking into a black space and I'm going to accept it, celebrate it, and learn from it. And I'm glad I did. So in doing so, we played popular music at every single performance. Every single one. There is no hesitation. If you go and watch some of our videos on YouTube, you will find something that either is popular, was on the top 100 billboards, or is on the radio right now. And that's how quick we're doing so. But in retrospect, I did not have that much of a great time in our wind ensemble. Programming was limited. We did not play anything remotely Latino and or Mexican, anything in my entire tenure in college. I was actually encouraged to not to be so LULAC. In case you don't know who LULAC is the largest and oldest civil rights organization for Latinos. And I was the president of our chapter in school. And so what you see there in the picture is we had a session to advocate for undocumented students because HB 1403 was going to get repealed and was taken away, which gave undocumented students the access to in-state tuition. So Dreamers, who had lived here since they were two, were getting charged as international students and no access to financial aid. But I was yet encouraged by mentors and professors, don't be so LULAC. But my space of affinity was my fraternity. I'm part of the largest Latino-based fraternity in the country, which is Sigma Lambda Beta, which you see in the picture up there. And I was with folks that were raised similarly like me, that had immigrant parents, that had hardworking, lower income at times, and modeled and aligned to my lived experiences. Now, a lot of them, if not all of them, are degreed and very well-off individuals, one of which is my primary care physician now. And I say that because it was this space of affinity. But Malagueña Salerosa, if you see the picture down there, that's my senior recital. And conveniently, it landed on Cinco de Mayo. You know, now I gave a little history on how Mexico actually doesn't really celebrate that except for the city of Puebla. But either way, I said, what better way to celebrate my identity and my culture than to end my senior recital with Malagueña Salerosa? So I invited the mariachi and I paid a whole hour just for them to come and play that one song. I have to go back to, get back here, sorry. Get to show you Dr. Mills' data real quick. Here we go.
Excellent. Thank you, Eric. And thank you to Dr. Messier and the lovely folks here at Dartmouth College for inviting me and for Eric for kind of wrapping me into this, as my work does intersect with what he's talking about in a very distinct way. So I'm very interested in my research on the ways that we're connected both within and between ensemble organizations. I'm a high school band director by trade and just kind of look at that stuff. And one of the things that popped to mind when Eric started talking about his experience in high school was that, yes, he didn't have access to anything remotely, as he says, Hispanic, Latinx, anything in terms of the music they performed in school. And you might look at that and go, well, that's intentional, especially with what the orchestra director said, we don't play that music here. That's not the thing we do. But what my research has shown is that what we actually find is that there wasn't that music available. One of the things about Texas to know is that we are one of few states that has a compulsory contest. Our students have to go to whether we call concert and sight reading contest every year, and we have to pick works from a prescribed list. That prescribed list sets the agenda, and it's a large list, about 1,200 pieces on there, so it's not small. But an analysis of that list, which is part of my research, looks at the ethnic and gender identity of the composers on that list. And what I did was took my list and compared it against all the schools in the region that Eric was in as a high school senior on his senior year. So this is 2005 when Eric graduated. Sorry to date you, Eric. And what this is a demographic breakdown of the composers that were available to be performed that were chosen by the schools. And what you find here on the far left, those are the white male composers. And it goes, white female composers, men of color, these are broad categories. And the NA is one person who I can't find. His last name is Trout, and he wrote a march, but that's really about as far as it goes. The internet is not a perfect tool for research, it seems. What's missing on here? Women of color. None were on the list in 2005. There's one on the list now, but that's a conversation for a later part of the presentation. But what this shows us is that it wasn't that a teacher said, I don't want that. It wasn't there to be played. It wasn't available. It wasn't at the table. Big as the table is, it was not there. And so what we find is the fact that I don't know how to do this. Apology. There we go. I see it now. And this is actually broken out by the classifications. So what you see here is 3C, 5A, 4A, 2C, 3A. It makes no sense unless you know it's very inside baseball. The A's are high schools. The C's are middle schools. And so Eric was in a 5A high school, Lamar High School in Houston ISD, which is a beautiful building on Westheimer in a very nice part of Hound River Oaks, if you're familiar with Houston. It's where Ted Cruz lives, but we don't like to claim that. So the 5A group here, you can see there were pretty much two works by people that weren't white men that were programmed that year. That's it, two works. So again, it wasn't that there was a choice made by the person who was teaching Eric. The choice was made by the people who created the list. Now, we are working to revise the list, but these were the only pieces programmed in Region 9 that year that were by men of color. And of that, only two of them were by Latino or Latinx identifying composers, Victor Lopez and Gabe Masella. And Gabe Masella is actually a band director in the area, so that kind of gives a little bit more credence. That's it. Out of how many schools would you say are probably in that area? Probably 200? Yeah. And then even outside of that, you look at suburbs, we're talking hundreds of schools, thousands of pieces, hundreds of directors, years of experience, and this is all that was available that was programmed. Now, there were probably about 50% more that were available that weren't programmed, but that's still a very small list when you consider the list they're picking from is 1,200 works. So it becomes something that we need to be aware of. And then we start to look because we know some things track together. We know that ethnic identity and socioeconomic status track together, and those are often predictive of things. Some people say that in social science, the only social science that has any predictive power is demography, and that's true. And so what we see here is a breakdown of the ISDs, we have independent school districts in Texas, that were comprised of Region 9. And we find Houston ISD way over here, significantly economically disadvantaged, so it'd be a Title I school. And this over here on the left is the demographic composite. What I did was took the demographics of the district for the year of 2005 and compared it against the census in 2000 and created a composite measure that tells us in a pretty shorthand way what the diversity was in that setting. So the lower the number, the more diverse, the higher the number, the less diverse, one group is gonna take over. And so we see Houston ISD is the most diverse, but also the most economically disadvantaged. Now, what does that amount to? Well, we start to compare, and we start to see patterns. So this is an illustration of that same chart we just saw, but added in is the composite of what the schools program. So this is looking at a lot of different factors. And what we find is we expect things like economically disadvantaged and diversity to track somewhat together. But when we look at this over here, the campus programming composite, all of a sudden we see all those schools are clustered together. They don't have a chance to respond to who the students are sitting in front of them, their backgrounds, their cultures, their lives, their lived experience, because they don't have the tools to speak to it. How can we, and this is an open question for all educators, and I'm an educator through and through, second generation, how can we respond to the students that we teach in a meaningful way if we don't have access to things to allow their lives to have meaning in their schooling and in their experience? The short answer is we don't. This just very vividly illustrates that very tight clustering on the campus programming composite, how everyone's kind of like within a certain range. That suddenly starts to tell us something. And they're only picking three pieces. Each school only picks three pieces per ensemble to take to contest. And so all of a sudden we start to see these clusters that are artificial. They're imposed by the structure, not imposed by the students, not imposed by the teachers, but imposed by the hierarchical organizations that allow for these things to continue and be perpetuated. This is, by the strictest of definitions, cultural superiority, and because the culture is white, it becomes white superiority in practice. This is what systemic racism looks like, okay, in pretty colors with graphs. But at the same time, it's true. It's funny because it's true. So did you want me to do the CBD and SF too? Okay. So if we even take this and telescope out, it's in the keynote. Okay, could you pull that up, please? I don't want to mess your computer up. My wife tells me I'm very good at doing that. Every time I fix her computer, it never is actually fixed. So the other thing, Okay, great. So this is, we're talking about collegiate trends. Eric mentioned you didn't really play anything that was strongly Latinx in college. This is a composite of, not even composite, it's a graph that shows self-reported, so it's not wholly accurate, but self-reported repertoire selections by colleges across the United States. And again, we see white male composers are far and away the leaders of who gets programmed at colleges and universities too. So this isn't just a K-12 issue, it's colleges that don't have a list to pick from. They get to pick their own music. And we see in that little stripe along the bottom, the mixture of white female composers, male composers of color, female composers of color, and non-binary composers. That very small sheen across the bottom represents what's available or what's been chosen to program. It's the canon, so to speak, of what we do in wind ensemble. And again, this is a breakdown by year. And the interesting thing here is this is actually a part of a larger report that I'm working on with the Institute for Composer Diversity, is that it is getting better. it recently, especially from 2017 forward, it's like the election of 2016 kind of motivated people to put what they thought into action, because we see a noticeable change starting 1617, 1718, 1819, 1920. We haven't analyzed 2021 because the pandemic is kind of not fair to look at things this way. That'll come eventually. But what we've seen in the orchestral world, because that's a separate report that we just published with the League of American Orchestras, is that it is a pretty significant uptick from 2019 onward. The summer of 2020 has had an impact. It has made its voice heard. So these sorts of things that Eric's experienced in his lived experience will hopefully become less and less over time. This is just a line graph illustration of the same data over time. You can see the trend downward, and I can tell you it continues. And then this is a heat map of the demographic composite of programming. Remember we talked about that earlier, where you take the composite, compare it against the state, and look at the differences. Darker colors here are more dominated by one racial group, by one demographic group. In this case, we know it's white men. We've seen the charts already. And so what you start to see is that there's a certain pattern to this, that there are some places that are lighter blue. That means there's a lot more diversity in how they program or who they program. And then darker, it's more kind of one flavor of ice cream, so to speak. Now, the interesting thing here is that there are some states where the information is missing, because again, this is self-report data. But the other thing is this: if you do a correlational analysis, and I don't want to put this up there because it's just too much, too many numbers, too many charts, between this and the demographics, it splits. There's like this artificial barrier. It's what we would call a confounding variable in statistics. And that confounding variable is access and availability of works by composers who aren't white men in these spaces. Now, these aren't the only spaces, as Eric so well pointed out. A lot of the musical lives of our children come from places that are not formal, that are not school, they're informal. The backyard mariachi that Eric showed us is a great example of how we're enculturated in music in ways that have nothing to do with our schooling. But if this is the 21st century and we're in the year 2022, why can't we make it a both and versus an either or? The access is there. Initiatives like this whole symposium and the Mexican music collection that is coming out of it are examples of that sort of thing in action. And this is one of hopefully many to come that allow for that. So I'll turn it back over to Eric now, but just to provide some context and some framework on which the tapestry of Eric's life is being stitched, this should at least give you an idea that this is not just Eric that's experienced this. This is something that everybody has experienced, and it hits you in different ways depending on what you bring to the table and how you use that information to either run away or move forward and lean in to try and fix. Eric.
So I worked really, really hard to develop my band director identity. Now, what does that mean? Our largest music convention is the TMEA, the Texas Music Educators Association Convention, that happens in San Antonio. And my thought process is, when they see me walk into the convention center, they think I teach mariachi. So I have to work twice as hard to make sure they see me as a competent band director, because I had two things against me. I was also an HBCU alum, which in the state of Texas has its own stigma, in the country as well, but in the state of Texas. So I was kind of already with a chip on my shoulder, and I was kind of raised that way. So I was like, I'm gonna go ahead and prove myself. So I worked really hard to do so. And in doing so, I started still trying to be creative and noticing that I have to program music because I didn't get that experience that makes them aware that there are sounds that relate to their lived experiences. So I would always, and I mean it, my entire career in public school setting, I programmed pasodobles. And that was just my thing, even though one of my mentors told me, do not do that. Don't ever do that, because they won't get the true feel of it. Every clinician, every judge that I've had said, wow, the artistry. I love the rubato and everything. I'm just like, come on, man. You know, these are the things that I was willing to do for my students. And then I also chose to do Latin closers for my jazz ensembles. The structure of jazz in a contest setting is a swing with an opener. You got a ballad for your second tune, and then a Latin funk or other. Kind of a rock piece. I never chose rock. Sometimes I do a little funk, but I mean, 9 times out of 10, I'm choosing some type of Latin closer. Now in jazz, it relates and aligns a lot more to Afro-Cuban rhythms. I was doing montunos and cha-cha, hence why you see the picture of an entire rhythm section for Latin percussion. So I would take off my drummer and put him on timbales or congas and bongos or cowbell. And my judges would be like, oh, I like the auxiliary percussion. I was like, no, it's the percussion, you know? And it's, but again, I'm getting judged that way. And even then, the folks that were supposed to inform me, I'm informing them. So there was still this disconnect happening. But because of my experience at an HBCU, I understood that these songs can be arranged by folks. And I can give them that experience. So the bottom picture is us rehearsing a cumbia mix. It was Sonora Dinamita, Fito Olivares, Selena, and Aniceto Molina, which Jorge talked about, where he's actually from Colombia that moved to Mexico and actually helped popularize the genre in Mexico. So I remember bringing it to my first high school, and I was like, let's do a cumbia mix. And they're like, no, mister, it's que, they're gonna decir que somos nacos. They were like, that term pretty much means like you're of lower class and from the rancho. And I asked, I was like, wait, do you dance these songs at home? Well, yeah. What, do you dance them at a quinceañera? Well, yeah. Then where's the shame coming from that you're not able to celebrate who you are inside the school building? And that was so telling to me, because I was teaching a majority Mexican-American student body, but yet then even 10, 15 years later, they're still dealing with some of the things that I dealt with that my friends were dealing with. Then I got creative. I had a student come and tell me, I want to study music. And he's like, but I don't want to tell you, mister, but I want to play tuba for a banda, you know? And I'm like, cool. And he's like, but I know I can't do that here in the States. And I was like, who said that? And he's like, well, they're all in Mexico. And I was like, no, they're not. You know, and he's like, what do you mean? I was like, man, some of the best ones are from Cali, you know, and they're developing. He's like, really? And I said, better yet, man, I have some partituras. I have some sheet music. Here, go start one. And he's like, huh? I said, go start one, but I don't want you to rehearse them as you think they're the wind ensemble or my marching band. Just go in there and have some fun, whoever you can get. He's like, okay, sir. I said, just let me know when you're going to rehearse. So he's like, hey, sir, you want to come next door? We're about to get ready. I was like, cool. I'm expecting 8 kids. There were 35 students in that room. And I was like, all right, well, let's go. They put on a concert by themselves. I was on paternity leave, and they put on the concert by themselves. That young man now is a music education student with me at my university. So what you can tell is I was willing to take risks. I was willing to do certain things that were unorthodox, going against the grain, even with folks that I admired and respected, that I just knew this is the right thing to do for my students. And selfishly, for me too. I was living vicariously through my students because of the lack of the experience.
So to illustrate even further this point that we all kind of know, but it's good to put numbers to it and good to put scope and scale to it, is this idea that everything is connected through networks. What I actually did here, this is for a different presentation, but it fit beautifully what we're talking about, especially with Eric being the band director at Heights, and he was a doctoral student with us at University of Houston at that point as well. And going in and seeing his students respond was beautiful. And I will say, nobody does a paso doble quite so well as Eric and his groups. But the thing is, getting back to this idea of these lists, most states in the part of the world that we live in that are considered banned states, which is kind of a both good and bad distinction, have lists. And what I did was took these lists and organized them as a social network. And so you can see the states that I chose here. You've got Texas, California, Florida, Indiana, and Georgia, all pretty known states. And what we do is we go, okay, this is everybody, and it's color-coded. Red is white male. It kind of goes on from there. 1,128 unique composers, about 4 works per composer, was what this came up with across all of these states. But then we start going, okay, who's doing what where? And so we look here. This is just what I call historically underrepresented groups or historically excluded composers. We drop now to 116. So we go from this hairball to not a hairball. And all of a sudden we see there's still connections. There's still this center group that are really well subscribed and kind of some people on the fringes that are less so. But again, we drop to average of 3 works per composer per list. Then we look at just female identifying composers. We're down to 42 unique composers, average of 2.5 works per composer per list. Going to composers of color broadly, this is men and women of color. 77, 1.7 works per composer per list. And when we say composer of color, this is anyone who's non-white. And I can talk, if you're interested, in how we determine demography and things like that and how we categorize folks. We have a whole system for that. I didn't want to take the time to walk through that bit of wonkishness. Male identifying composers of color, 74. So notice here, if we're following along, do the math. 77 composers of color, 74 male composers of color. 2.3 words per composer per list. Women of color across five of the largest band states in the United States of America. Three, average of 1.2 works per composer per list. And so that we can put faces with names, these are them. These are the three composers who run these lists. Kit Nishimura, Yukiko Nishimura, and Jennifer Jolly. Now, things have gotten better. These are all sampled in 2020, so things have improved, but yet we see going from here to here just how far we are from fully having access to tools to represent the people sitting in front of us in our classrooms in K through 12 settings. And I know it seems rather pedantic when we're talking about things that are very beautifully broad and artistically rich, but this is where it starts. This is where it starts for students in the United States, is in classrooms, in band halls, as we call them in Texas, or band rooms, as they call them everywhere else. This is where it starts. And if it's not there, it's tough, tough going to make it take root beyond that point. We know how enculturation works. Part of why that student had to sit with his, like his knees on bricks, is because they understand the incentive there is to learn English. They incentivize the activity they want. I don't think this is something anyone planned, but I think this is just as much as we saw earlier, that institutionalized or systemic racism at work might have been started with the best of intentions. And I think we all wanted to get better. I'm actually working with the head of our program in Texas on diversifying the list. But nonetheless, it also becomes that these three women, beautiful, wonderful composers, had to fight through a lot. You know, I actually know Jennifer very well. She will tell you it was not an easy road to get where she is, and it's not an easy road to keep going. This needs to be better. And there are plenty of composers out there that we can attach to, which some of them are fortunately sitting in this room right now. So that is something that we are going to be working on. But again, just wanted to provide context of how, not how far we have to go, but where we are starting from, right? Because it's going to look like it's going to look when we get there, but knowing where we're starting from is a powerful thing because it tells us where to go next or where we can go next and what to do about it when we get there.
So what can we do to relate and create access? So I mentioned a few things about the lack of access for me. So if you are not aware, there's an app called TikTok, and students are going crazy for it, and myself included. I scroll sometimes. I want to give you an insight at what folks are doing. All right. So the first video is a mariachi. He also puts up just note names at times. At times, he only puts up note names instead of just the sheet music. And some would say, purists would say, that's not how we learn music here. So just the flexibility in allowing that. The second video, the young lady in the middle has been one of my past podcast guests, where she's playing accordion here, but studied classical violin and just graduated with her bachelor's degree and did a stitch with folks nowhere near her geographically. She started the video and posted it. The next person stitched it, did a duet. The next person stitched it, did a duet. Just off of what's been there. Then the last one, this one really was telling. There's a new genre, fairly new, within Mexico and the United States called corridos tumbados. And it's taken off. It is popular. And if this stitch video does not tell you just how popular this genre has become, they actually advocated and said, stitch us. They put the lyrics up on their video of their arrangement. And the young lady stitched it and sang her version of it. So then after that, I was like, well, how many people did this? I stopped the video before I stopped scrolling. Just to give you an insight of how music is being made digitally and through social media. So as music educators, we must recognize, challenge, question, and take advantage of the opportunities for music teaching and learning available to us in a digitally networked society. Otherwise, we risk irrelevancy. Before I went to Prairie View full-time, I was teaching at a high school in Houston. I had gone back full-time because I was still on a part-time basis. I needed a full-time job. I have two beautiful kids. I needed to have a full-time job. So I went back. And when I went back, I went with a stronger sense of identity that I ever had in my career. And when I say a stronger sense, my students would ask me, hey, mister, are you Mexican? Ah, todo dar. You know, and I would respond in Spanish. Tengo el nopal en la frente. No me lo ves? Like I have the cactus on the front of my head. That's a saying, a colloquialism that we have, saying, how Mexican are you? The honor is. And then I just kind of didn't realize how much of an impact that made on my students. So I want to read this letter that I received from one of my graduating seniors. Just messing, she actually put, to who it may concern. Just mess around. It was truly nice to see myself represented by having a Latino band director. Double points for being one of the few open-minded Latino men when it comes to talking about Latinx. It felt nice to be seen and talked about in a respectful way. As you may know, or maybe not, I identify as non-binary. What made your open-mindedness even funnier is whenever you discuss Latinx, I felt your eyes would lock onto me as if you already sensed that I was of said category. Then again, you were great at maintaining proper eye contact, but either way, thanks for being you. And I did not realize, I mean, I read this admittedly in traffic in Houston, we were stopped, but I was literally deadlocked in traffic and I pulled out the letter and I choked up because I recognized the fact that if we want representation, we need visibility first, but then also the ability to strengthen our students like me to have pride and a sense of just overall joy of their identity, whether it be racial, ethnic, sexual, whatever, and creating that space to not only acknowledge, but to celebrate them. And so I had to, and I had to preface this. They both gave me permission to post their letters. And so the picture you see up there, the other young lady on the left, and I got to mention this as well, both of them lost their parents last semester. The non-binary student lost her mother. And then my other student lost her father at the beginning of the school year. And I mean, whether they just started acknowledging me or revering me from there, because I remember what we do as specifically Mexicans is when we go, damos el pésame, we go take food. We share a meal. So when I showed up to her house, I got permission. I said, me das permiso llegar a tu casa. Can I have permission to go and just give my pésame to your family? She said, yes, sir. And so I showed up with a big old pot of my mom's pozole. And I said, this is for my mom. And she said she never forgot that, you know? And then to me, I was like, it's not much out of my time or effort. So we owe it to each other and our students to provide them with the music learning experiences and opportunities that affirm their identities and positively contribute to their music and identity development. This is a nod to Dr. Henninger and Andrea Sanchez. She is the, I believe she's the associate dean, or she's the director of the Teaching and Learning Center at Texas Tech University. And this just really summarizes my life experience and how indirectly I didn't get discouraged from doing it, but rather I had the chip on my shoulder to prove them wrong and get in those spaces to change the narrative and change how we teach music. So thank you so much for having us. If you want to scan the QR code, that gives you access. The QR code will give you access to my podcast and all my social media links as well. I have a podcast on urban music education that has been going on for about 2.5 years now. Myself and a co-host are also trying to change the narrative of how people, we're trying to pretty much reclaim the term urban and not let it be coded, where people, other folks talk about me in a way that they don't understand. So we chose to do it and change the narrative. And so we've interviewed several guests, one of which is Sixto, that Our effort is to overall just share these positive messages from across the country. So thank you.